I'm recording now. Now the story's over. She goes completely silent. Mom had this great story about Ruth Brockelbank using her wooden leg to threaten children that whatever gripe you got in life, you got nothing on me, kids. You better suck it up and do the right thing.
That's right.
I'm the teacher.
I'm tough.
I'm tough.
I'm smart. I'm old. I'm tough.
And I'll take my leg off and beat the table to get your attention.
That was back in the days, probably in the 50s. More respect for teachers, less arguing. Parents stuck up for the teacher. Kids didn't have a chance back in the day. Ruth Brockelbank lived in West Springfield, Massachusetts. She was an old maiden lady, a cousin to my father. When we first used to visit her, I remember she had a big goldfish pond in her yard, which was quite amazing.
Those goldfish must have been tough to live through those Massachusetts winters. Yeah. Must have been deep.
Perhaps it was. I only remember. It was round. It had stones around the edge. It was in the backyard.
Neat. All right.
That's the story of Ruth Brockelbank, who broke her leg in a car accident. And the leg couldn't survive. Back in the 60s, back in the 50s, artificial legs were made out of a block of wood. They were hard. She used to say, here, tap on this leg. Well, okay, I'll tap on this leg because you're older and you're wiser and you're an adult and there's no option here. I must tap on your leg. Yes, it's a hard leg. It was painted more or less the color of her skin. It had her shoe attached. It was the olden days with an artificial leg.
It was one shoe all the time?
Yeah.
She couldn't change shoes?
No. It was a black shoe. It was one of those black old-fashioned lady shoes with sort of a one-inch heel. And you tied the shoe on the other foot. I guess you could have changed it, but she never did. I don't think there was any interest in having nylons or socks or anything. It was just a piece of wood with a shoe attached to the bottom. And I can't remember how attached to her. Some metal concoction, contraption. I don't remember. I couldn't remember whether she taught after she had a wooden leg or if she got a wooden leg when she was retired. That would be interesting to find out, but nobody would know. Give me an answer to that question. But she was close to our family because she recognized my father was a smart one, and she helped him with a little bit of money when he was in Campbell Union Academy. When he got to be 16, his father said, there's no reason for us to keep feeding you, go somewhere else. So at 16, he got a job at a school, Campbell Union Academy, and it was a high school, and he lived there, and he was the janitor and also a student. But while his food and his room and his books were paid for by his work as a janitor. From there, Campbell Union Academy, he went to Dartmouth, and he worked his way through Dartmouth, and from Dartmouth he went up to Canada to McGill University for medical school. And he basically was on his own since he was 16. But occasionally Ruth would send him a little money. And at a certain point when he was in a residency in West Springfield, for some reason she knew somebody who knew somebody that the town of Ashburnham needed a doctor. And so I think there was a letter around someplace that Ruth Brockelbank actually contacted someone in the town and gave a good report on Grandpa Mason, and then she gave him some money to be able to put whatever money it took to get a place to live. So she either paid some rent or she gave him some every month to go toward the rent while he was getting started. And then as soon as he had any money, his first job was to be paying her back so she would have money to live on in her old age. She was a wise woman who tried to help out Grandpa Mason because his family didn't have any money. And I don't know what she did for other people in the family. Aunt Florence, the oldest, somehow became a dietitian. I don't know how she found the money for doing that. And then after Grandpa Mason, there was Uncle Sidney who learned to do, we called him a landscaper, but primarily he was a tree person. Sawed them down, cut them up, etc. And after that, it was Uncle Bob who worked for the railroad, and after that, Aunt Mary went to nursing school. No, Uncle Bob was the youngest. Well, nobody ever knows what Uncle Leland did, except he didn't do much of anything. Very smart man who didn't. He could espouse philosophy for hours, but he didn't want to do anything that required any effort, so he was a person that it was lots of fun to talk to, but I don't know that he got much respect. So we had a good time once in a while, maybe once a year. If Grandma Mason still lived on Sharron Hill, we would go to Sharron. We'd get some ungodly hour that I don't know what it was, but Wesley would, and they would put boxes and blankets on the back seat of the car, on the floor behind the front seats, and it would be a big bed, and Uncle Wesley and I would sleep. They would put us in there asleep, and then we would go probably 2 hours north to Bellis Falls and stop at a diner for breakfast, and then we would be almost in Sharron. We have another hour to go after that, so it'd be like a 3 hour trip. Go up for a day, or go up and stay a few days. And it was an old, nice old farmhouse, smelled like an old farmhouse. You could go down in the cellar, get eggs. I still have to look up the Eisen glass. I don't know. It was some kind of a thick liquid that you could keep eggs in all winter, and I don't know what it was. And I don't know why you'd even do that. If you had a hen house, you could just walk next door and get a fresh egg. But in any event, they did have that. Maybe that was security in case hens went. Maybe hens don't want to lay eggs in them when they're freezing cold in the winter. I don't know. I remember the back kitchen, big back kitchen, that had the cream separator, a big machine, sort of like an old-fashioned washing machine. I don't know if it had any power to it or not. But you turn something, the cream ended up on the top and the milk ended up in the bottom. And you could sell the cream and you could use whatever milk you wanted and give the rest to the pigs. Pigs were out back. There was a garden out back and pigs, and it was a place called Beaver Meadow because you could look down there, see where the beaver house was, and like the swamp. Go upstairs in the farmhouse, and the boys had one side, whoever there was, and the girls had the other side, whoever there was. And there was a little door you could go out and go crawl on top of the sheds. That was a fun thing to do. You would find all kinds of old broken bits of tools and this is and that. And then there was three sheds. The first shed, I think, was the wood shed. The second shed was where you could put a car, and the third shed was where there was different tools and this is and that. You could go down the road to the big cow barn and dump on the hay. You could milk the cows and squirt milk to the cats. walking around. You could go in a different building that was the ice house full of straw and chunks of ice from the winter. You could go walk up the big dirt road that went up the hill and catch the salamanders that were crawling on the road in the rain. It was good things to do there. Good things.
Neat.
It was a big old fireplace. I think Uncle Cindy built the fireplace. You could have picnics out there. You could just go out in the nighttime, toast marshmallows, and sit outside. It was a fun place to be a kid. I think if you were grown up, it'd be a lot of work.
Thank you, Mom. Memories of Sharron.
Sharron Hill.
Sharron Hill, Vermont. Where the Masons lived for a long time.
That's right. Yeah, no, I think it's sold away. Yeah, we went there, I don't know, 5 years ago? 10 years ago? My cousin David Cooley wanted to bring those people his book of History of the Masons, so we went in there, and the house was basically all changed around, where there was a parlor and a bedroom, turned into just like the family room, where there was a kitchen, the kitchen side, they changed that around.
Hmm.
They had a big stairway with a machine, or whatever you call it, could bring a person with disabilities up to the second floor.
Ah, okay.
So that man was in his chair. I didn't see him move out of his chair. But that rail or track or something was going up the stairs, and the stairs were really big, right opposite the front door. So it was still being used for a house maybe 10 years ago. I don't know what happened after that.
Hmm.
Maybe it's there, maybe it's not. But it's interesting to go up. We went up to Sharron Hill with the Cooleys, we'll say 5 or 10 years ago. The main road going up to Sharron Hill, you just look at it, you say, that's the church that was there when I was small. That's the same grocery store that was there when I was small. It's got that same old-fashioned screen door thing. It's like a screen door, but it's a stronger mesh on the bottom, so kids aren't going to stick their feet through the, kick it closed or open. The Cooleys took us up to the cemetery, not too far from the church where my grandpa Mason is buried, and my grandma Mason is buried, and Cooley's daughter, who died from diabetes, she's buried there too.
Hmm.
That's just down the road from the church and the store. So if you ever go to Sharron Hill, if you ever go to Sharron for any reason, just go down the road a little bit from the church and the grocery store, and you'll see the cemetery up on a hill, right at the very top of the hill, as far up as you can go. That's where the Masons and the Cooleys are buried.
Hmm.
I think Aunt Florence is there too.
Hmm.
There. How's that?
Wonderful, Mom. Thank you.
There's a story.
Yep, stories.